Psalm 40, verses 1 through 3, we find these words: I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, set my feet upon a rock, and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. So I invite you to take your hymn book and let's sing hymn number 448, a song of praise, He Ransomed Me. 448, we'll stand and sing all three verses. Let's have prayer. Dan, would you open in prayer, please?
Lord, Heavenly Father, we just come with joyful hearts this morning that we have been ransomed by your Son. May that just encourage us to worship you in spirit and truth, Lord, to have joyful hearts. And may you pastor as he brings forth your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And we don't use the word ransomed often anymore, but we've been studying about it in Sunday school. The word redemption means that God has bought us. He's bought us out of slavery to sin, out of underneath the guilt of sin, out of underneath the law. He's redeemed us. All right, just some upcoming events here. First of all, this Saturday from about 1 to 3, the church will be reserved for a memorial service. So if you're on cleaning or whatnot, try to make the church available during that time, okay? I did get this snowman for a sale, needs repairs. You can pick these up in Buffalo. I hear they got a lot of them. Anyways, Wednesday night, we always have our prayer meeting, which we have singing and Bible study, prayer time, and fellowship. I encourage you to join us every Wednesday night. Sunday school classes every Sunday morning at 9:45. Our adult class, we're meeting in the chapel area there, and Vance is leading a study in Galatians, which is excellent. I put this up here because last week, some of our littler ones from junior church stayed up with us to observe and learn about the Lord's Supper. And Zeke did a worksheet. It was his first one last week. And he did a great job in that. Praise the Lord. And not only that, Neely, she turned in a worksheet and did excellent on it also. Not to be undone by Elliot, who every week after week, Elliot is probably our most faithful person in doing worksheets. Congratulations to Elliot. And Dalton is another one that has been doing worksheets for the last couple of years. Almost every single week he gets us in and does a great job on those. So we commend our young people. And then I shouldn't forget, but Kennedy Crocker stayed up last week also and did a worksheet. Unfortunately, she left it in the pew, so I only got it this morning. But she did an excellent job on her worksheet also. So praise the Lord. You know, when you see these little kids running around, don't forget to pray for them and love them and encourage them in the things of the Lord, because this is the next generation. And I look around our church and I just praise the Lord that we have young people that are growing up to know and love the Lord and in good families. This is the next generation. If you go to a lot of churches today, you won't find anybody under about 65 years of age. When my wife and I are on vacation, we always go to church, and very often we're the youngest people in the assembly, and that's really sad. But praise the Lord for all of our young people, and you keep encouraging them. Venables and Gefell's cleaning church this week. Bill Morrison on snow shoveling, which we haven't had to do any yet, but it's coming, hopefully. Next Sunday, with you, bring a dish to pass, and plan on staying for our fellowship lunch. And we'll have just a little short Bible study after our fellowship lunch, but encourage you all to stay for that. All right, and then, I don't know if it's going to be the 18th or 25th, but in 2 or 3 weeks on a Wednesday night, we are going to have a business meeting, it's our quarterly meeting, and we'll need a brief quarterly reports from our committees and officers, so just get working on that. If you cannot be here for some reason that night, please get your report written up, just a little paragraph or whatever, a summary of what's going on. Keep everybody up to date and get that to somebody else so that can be presented at our meeting, okay? If there's no other announcements, take your Bibles, please, and turn to Philippians chapter 3 with me. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, and beginning at verse 10, Paul says this. This is one of his resolutions, if you will. It's not a New Year's resolution. It's his resolve. It's his intent. That I may know him, that is Christ, really know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings. And not many of us have that resolution, do we? The fellowship of his suffering. Fellowship means to participate, share in the sufferings of Christ. Now, it's never going to be a matter of our paying for our sin. That's not what he's talking about. But he says if he's counted worthy to suffer for Jesus, for his preaching of the gospel or living like a Christian, and he's going to suffer because of it, he says, praise the Lord. That's what I want. I want to be like Christ. And if it means following in his suffering, that's what I want to do. And so he says, I wanna know him. I want to know the power of his resurrection that is in my life. I want to have that resurrection life. I want the fellowship of his suffering, to share in his sufferings and be conformed to his death. If by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Well, I could do a whole message on that phrase, if by any means. I just saw that there. Huh. Doesn't matter which way. Doesn't matter how I die or how God takes me through life, whatever the means, whatever the ups and downs and trials and stresses of life, whatever, I want to come to that goal ultimately that he has for me, the resurrection from the dead. Verse 12, not that I have already attained or have already perfected. None of us have reached sinless perfection, have we? Nor did the Apostle Paul. But he says, I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ has laid hold of me. That idea of laying hold of has the idea of ownership. God, Christ, laid hold of Paul. claimed him as his own child and gave him a mission and gave him a purpose, didn't he? To teach and preach the unsearchable riches of Christ. And Paul says, I want to lay hold of, I want to take ownership of what God has laid hold of, ownership of me for. And then he says in verse 13, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. It's actually the same word as he used, laid hold of. I haven't got there yet. I haven't accomplished what I'm supposed to. But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. What a great resolution this would be for all of us to make. We haven't attained what we were supposed to yet. None of us have reached sinless perfection, but we're pressing on, right? Forgetting those things which are behind, Paul says. Now, it doesn't mean he's obliterated his memory, can't remember a thing, because in fact, chapter 3, he actually, back in verses 5, 6, he actually talks about his Jewish heritage. Didn't forget that. Verses 9, 10, 11, 12, he talks about some of his Christian experiences. Didn't forget about those. But when he's talking about forgetting those things which are behind, he's not recalling or bringing up anything that's going to impede his progress into reaching his goal, his purpose for which Christ laid hold of him. I'm going to put those things behind me, whether they were my attainments or my victories or my failures. I'm not going to let that ever impede my progress in living and serving the Savior, becoming what I ought to be, Christ-like. That's his goal. You notice it's intentional, isn't it? He's got a goal. He's got a purpose. He's got a mark. I press toward the goal for the prize. He's living his life with a purpose, a mission, intentional. I know that God has called me to be his child. He's called me to be like him, to honor him, to serve him, to obey him, to teach and preach the gospel. That's what I'm going to do. Everything in my life, I'm going to set my mind on, I'm going to focus on, I'm not going to let those things of my past inhibit my progress. Disrupt my work. You know, sometimes even sin of our past failures, Christians sometimes hang on to those things. And we those things impede our progress for Christ. We become so obsessed with some sin or failure in our past, and maybe it was a terrible sin, a terrible failure. Maybe it was years you spent wandering away from God and making a mess of your life. Paul says, I'm not going to remember that either. I'm forgetting those things. Why? Because if we've forsaken that, it's been forgiven by God. He's cleansed us from every sin, washed us, purged us, cleansed us. It's been forgiven, obliterated, expiated. It's gone. And any Christian that holds on to the past and look back and having those sins and failures derail them in the present, if they're bogging you down or robbing you of the joy of the Christian life, if you're carrying around guilt from past sin that's already been forgiven, that's a terrible thing, and it has no part in the Christian life. In fact, it's really slanderous to God. You're saying that God really hasn't forgiven you, or he can't forgive you, or he's an Indian giver or something of that nature, or slandering Christ as if his sacrifice for my sin and his payment for my sin wasn't sufficient to cover my sin. It was. And God did forgive it if you've confessed it to him. So don't be walking around with guilt and complaining and griping about past failures. Put it behind you and move on for Christ. Set a goal. God has called me. He saved me to be like him. And I'm going to focus every energy on being that. Paul said that in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I think it was, when he says, I so run, not as uncertainly. In other words, I have my eye on the goal. I fight, not as one who beats the air. I'm not just shadow boxing. I've got a purpose, a goal, and it's not just running in circles, but it's running toward a goal. I hope you have goals, purposes. Understand what God has called you to be. And you say, okay, you know what, Lord? That's what I want my life to be then, and I'm going to forget those things which are behind. Victories and failures. Set my eyes on the future for what Christ has for me. Philippians 3, what a great passage, a passage of resolution. Well, let's take our hymn books and we're going to sing a song about that. Let's move on to higher ground. 308. 308, let's stand as we sing. I hope you can sing this honestly. You're pressing on the upward way. Seated. Good singing. Ushers, come and receive our Lord's tithes and offerings, please. Charlie, would you ask God's blessing on our offerings, please?
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day to be able to meet in this building to hear your word, to fellowship. We thank you, Lord, for your word and pray, Lord, that you'll enable us to be a testimony and witness for thee throughout this week, as well as we pray, Lord, for the needs of our government. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
460, leaning on the everlasting arms. We'll sing all three verses. Let's stand. 460. Thank you. We'll dismiss our children for children's church. Anno Domini, for hundreds of years, we knew it as that. It's medieval Latin, means the year of our Lord. So welcome to the year of our Lord, 2023. And you know what? It is his year. And therefore, we just sang that, what have I to dread, what have I to fear? David said in Psalm 31, my times are in thy hand. Our times, every bit of them, every day, every minute, every hour, every year, it's in the Lord's hands. This is the year of our Lord. He's the owner of time, creator of time. So we don't need to fear anything that's going to happen this year. Nothing. How many made New Year's resolutions? Oh. Well, I guess I won't preach on this. A lot of people, a lot of Christians, don't make New Year's resolutions. And the reason they don't, none of you did, is because you say, well, resolutions, New Year's resolutions aren't biblical. They're not in the Bible. Neither is Christmas. And yet we use Christmas as a wonderful time to pause and remember one of the greatest truths in the Bible, the incarnation of the Son of God, when he came in the flesh for us, though the celebration of Christmas is certainly not in there. Resolutions are not in your Bible either. And yet I think people who make resolutions are on a good start. Some people don't keep resolutions, or don't make resolutions because they say, well, you're not going to keep them anyways. And it's true that probably 98% of people who make New Year's resolutions don't make it more than a couple of weeks. For 28 years, I was a member of the Penfield Fitness and Racket Club in Penfield there on Panorama Trail. And every January, the place was packed. Everybody got New Year's memberships and joined the club those first two, three, 4 weeks in January. By middle of February, it pretty much died out. By March, it was down to the same old 25 people that have been there year after year. Most people just don't keep resolutions. But even if you're not going to keep them, to me, I think it's a good thing. Because at least that means you've given some thought. You've looked over your life and said, you know what, there's something that needs to change. That's a good start. In fact, that's where every improvement begins, is by looking and saying, you know, something needs to change. So at least the person who's made a resolution has looked and said, you know what, some things aren't what they're supposed to be. I got to change something. So that's good. And particularly if you've made a specific resolution, you've even gone a step farther and you have identified a specific need in your life that needs changing. And as Christians, we need to be doing that. Someone could maybe close that back door. Thank you. Not to keep people out, just to keep the sound down a little bit. But identifying a problem and need in our life and addressing it and saying, I'm going to resolve, and as a Christian we say, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, Lord willing, I'm going to make an improvement in my life in an area that needs change. That's a good thing. So even if you don't follow through after a month or two, at least well begun, I would encourage you to redo it again and again and again. Resolutions are good. And I know the word resolution is only found in the Bible, I think, one or two times in most of our English translations. But the Bible uses other words that talk about resolution. For example, when we come to the Lord's Supper, he tells us to examine ourselves. This is supposed to be done on a regular basis. Examine yourself. Take a stock. What is your relationship with God? What's your relationship with your fellow Christians? What is your life? He says, examine yourself. And involved in that examination is putting yourself to the test, to the fire. And it would imply that you make improvement, that you burn off the dross, that you make resolve, you confess sin, you move on like Paul did, forgetting that which is behind and pressing on. So every time we have the Lord's Supper ought to be a time of resolution. I would suggest every single day you wake up with a prayer to live for God, that you resolve to do better than you did yesterday. Every single time you hear the Word of God preached, every time you read the Word of God, this is God speaking to you, you should have a resolve, right? God speaks and I'm listening. Well, that should be your first resolution. Lord, help me to listen. But then when God speaks and I listen, our resolve ought to be, Lord, help me to believe that. Help me to obey that. Help me to practice that. Maybe it's going to involve confession, repentance, whatever, but there's resolve. If God said it, then I want to do it. So every single time we hear the Word of God read or preached, we should be making some resolutions. The Word of God does use these words: to think upon, to reconsider, to reckon, to examine, to test, to judge, discern, remember, repent, aim, decide, purpose, fix one's mind. These are all words that kind of mean the same thing as make a resolve. Move on, set your eyes and focus and do something. So resolutions, though they're not particularly New Year's resolutions, are not in the Bible. Christians ought to be full of resolve and constantly working at that, growing in the Lord. Well, this morning I want to not talk about New Year's resolutions, but I just want to give some of my, that's not me there. But I want you probably already noticed that I am getting older. I've been dyeing my hair gray the last few years. Have you noticed that? But I want to give you some of my just ponderings over the last few weeks, reflections, reckonings, whatever, rememberings, some testifying. And I think they're biblically based. I think they're good things for Christians to consider, and I would hope you follow along with me this morning. First thing is the sufficiency of God's grace.
Amen.
I know that's nothing new to you, but it's something you ought to ponder on a regular basis, how good God's grace is. When I set to look back over the last year, I really don't have a, it's not fixed from January 1st to December 31st in my mind. When I look back, it's kind of a clump of years of when Deb got cancer, and that was sort of right at the beginning of COVID. And then we had the evil shutdown and the aftermath of that. And so I kind of clump all that together. To me, it's cancer, COVID, shutdown, aftermath. And I kind of look at that, as far as Deb and I go, as one big block of time. And I just rejoice in God's grace. That while the world was fretting and stewing, and we had even more to fret and stew about, we didn't. God graced us, enabled us to have a joy and a peace and a hope that transcended any fears. If not fear of cancer, not fear of COVID, not... God has just blessed and gave us a joy unspeakable. And the ministry went on, and God's church went on, and people's lives were touched, and the gospel went forward, and there were people saved, and our church continued to grow. And that's the grace of God. That's the grace of God, and it was a joy. I think of the sufficiency of God's grace when I think of my own salvation. I knew it. Going back 43 years when I came to this church, there were a couple things that I did know in my head. I knew I wasn't worthy of salvation, that I was saved by grace. By grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. I knew that I didn't earn it or deserve it, but God in his grace loved me, called me, saved me, made me his child, adopted me into his family. That's all of God's grace, not of me. The second important thing I knew was that my training, my innate abilities and skills to be called to work in the ministry of the gospel and to shepherd God's flock was insufficient. That I knew that I was over my head. And even although there was only a handful of people when I came, I knew I was still over my head in this ministry. To be called to shepherd a flock of God was a supernatural work, a divine work. And I needed God's grace. And praise the Lord, God's grace is sufficient in his salvation and calling to the ministry. God is always sufficient. It's all sufficient and always sufficient grace. When God calls you to do something, when God asks you to do something, when God commands you to do something, he will grace you to do it. When God calls you to go through a difficult time, the loss of a loved one, the waywardness of a son or a daughter, whatever it is, God will give you grace to bear up. He told Paul this, 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He said to me, this is when Paul remembered the thorn in the flesh, and three times he begged of the Lord, he besought the Lord thrice, to Lord, remove this thorn in my flesh, this messenger of Satan. And God said to him, my grace is sufficient for you, Paul. My strength is made perfect in weakness. In other words, God's strength. God says, my strength is made perfect. It's completed. When you're in your weakest state, that's when God is stronger. And Paul replied, therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Because God's grace is always and all sufficient. In 1 Corinthians 15:10, he says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, it was the grace of God which was with me. God's grace. Grace, it's the word, it means a gift. God gifts us, and then he gives us gifts to enable us to use our gifts. And then He gives us the attitude and the will and the motivation to serve. And it's all of grace. It's all God. The salvation, the calling, the gifting, the serving, everything. It's the grace of God. And I praise the Lord for his all-sufficient grace. There were times over the last 43 years, I went through times of discouragement. And you wonder sometimes, weeks on end or months on end, whether God is doing anything or accomplishing anything or using you for anything. Is my ministry worthless? Am I worthless? And then sometimes he gives you those gracious moments where you can look back and he says, no, look what I'm doing. I'm always at work. I'm always in control. I'm always fulfilling my plan. I'm always doing what's best. And you get to see that God is at work. God is always at work. And God uses us, sinful, broken clay pots. Yes, by his grace, he uses us. Grace Baptist Church, yes, he uses us. God's grace. Second thing I want to think about is the importance of right choices and priorities. Life is about making choices, right choices. Every day we make hundreds of choices. Do you make godly ones? Do you make biblical choices? Do you make wise choices? Do you do what matters? No, let me rephrase that. Do you do what matters eternally? There's a lot of things that matter in life. There are important things that matter, but then there are important things that matter for eternity. Those choices that we make. If you would, turn in your Bibles to 1 John. 1 John chapter 2. The main thing I want to bring out here about is the right choices and the priorities. I always have to do with people. People, not things. People need to be your priority. Personal relationships need to be your priority. Your relationship with God is obviously number one. Your relationship with your family, your Christian family, your spouse, your children, your grandchildren. 1 John chapter 2, beginning at verse 15. John says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, it's not of the Father, it's of the world. And the world, and all of its stuff, by the way, the world is passing away. It's temporary. It's fleeting. It rusts, it inflates, it wears out, it breaks. Everything in this world, the world is passing away and the lusts of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Amen. That phrase, he who does the will of God, that's just a phrase that John saying, the true Christian. That's what is a hallmark of a true Christian is one who does the will of God. Remember in Matthew, matter of fact, let's turn over to Matthew chapter 7. That's the essence of it in Matthew chapter 7, where Jesus said that many shall say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not done this and done that and all these fancy things? And Jesus will say, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Matthew chapter 7. Verse 21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but what? He who does the will of my Father in heaven. That's the person who's truly a Christian, the one who does the will of my Father. Because many will say, oh, Lord, Lord, we prophesied, we cast out demons, we've done many wonderful things in your name. I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. And then he gives an illustration, a parable of the two builders. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them. You see, the true Christian is somebody who does the word of God. Hears the word of God and he does it. Whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, beat on the house, and it did not fall because it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, beat on the house, and it fell, and great was its fall. There's your wise man, your fool man. There's your Christian, your non-Christian. So anyways, back in 1 John, when he talks about he that does the will of God abides forever, the true Christian is the one who hears the word and believes it and obeys it. Now, not perfectly, but in general, he's a doer of the word. So we have two things here. We have the world and all this stuff in it that's passing away, it's fleeting. And then you have this person over here, he who does the will of God abides forever. Christians are immortal. What are you going to waste your time with? This crap over here that's rotting, dying, rusting, corroding, going out of whatever. It's not going to work anymore. Like Luann's stove, 2 years old, it broke. Her oven's no good. 2 years. Or are you going to invest in this person over here who does the will of God, who's forever, immortal? I'm going to live with him forever because I'm immortal. I'm one of God's children. It's people that I want to establish relationships with, those who will live forever. Immortal souls. Invest in the lives of Christians. It's an eternal investment. There's a difference between what's important and what's eternally important. There are things in this life we have to do. You have to get up and go to work because God calls us to go to work, provide for our families. There are things you have to do as a citizen of the United States, a homeowner. You got to mow your lawn. You got to fix the toilet when it's broke. You got to clean the house. You got to vacuum. You got to rake leaves. There are some things that we have to do just being part of life in this world. We do. But then there's things that are of eternal importance, and that is my spouse, my wife, my children, my grandchildren, my church family, my Christian brotherhood. Those are things, and my relationship, my time spent with them are of eternal importance. They have to have the priority. I know we have to make time for some of these other things, but my family and my Christian family has to be of utmost importance. Immortal souls. So maybe that would be a good resolution. Lord, give us discernment in how I spend my time, how I invest my energy. Is it in stuff that's going to be no good in a few years anyways? Or is it going to be in people and lives and in relationships that will be forever? It's people, not stuff that matters. One of my resolutions again this year was to continue my disuse of the ever-addicting, seemingly ubiquitous presence of a smartphone. I know that falls on hard hearts for most of you because you got smartphones and you love them. I don't have one and I don't want one. And I see, you know, 14 years ago, none of you had them. In fact, for 5,000 years, life went on pretty good without them. And now it's in Google we trust, in Alexa we trust. You can't get from point A to point B unless you're following her. And I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings here. I already have. I don't. Feel free never to show me anything on your phone, okay? I know you all have already, and so I don't want anyone to feel bad because you're all guilty. If you've got a smartphone, I'm sure you've already showed me something on it. Anyways, it's people, it's you. Call me up, stop in for coffee, okay? I don't know how much time you spend on Facebook or on TikTok or on Twitter or in your computer games or watching television, but may I suggest as a child of God that you start investing in people. Call up people, talk to people, have people over into your house, have coffee, have them, meet them for supper. Be with Christians. And then not just be with Christians, but be intent on being a godly influence on them so that when they go home, they somehow reflect Christ more than when you got together. Somehow you passed on something of goodness, godliness, a blessing. Somehow you uplifted them spiritually. Somehow your attitudes, your conduct, your being with them, your conversation, encourage them to go on with Christ somehow. They're on a higher plane than when you got with them the first time. People. The people of God, the family of God. If you're a Christian, that's who you're going to spend eternity with. And the stuff of this world that you're grasping at, you're not going to have a smartphone in heaven, okay? Another one of my ponderings, sin. I used the word endlessness there, but I shouldn't. It's probably not a good word because sin will end eventually. But it's seemingly endless. Pull, drag, the tenacity of sin's temptation. It never lets up. This world has changed dramatically in the last couple of years. You know it. People have changed. There's been a great reset in our world. But you know what hasn't changed? Sin. It is as powerful as ever. Satan hasn't changed a bit. He's roaming around as a roaring lion seeking to destroy, seeking whom he may devour. Sin's temptation is no less than it ever was. And as I look back, I think to myself, well, I recall as a young person struggling with certain sins. And I'm thinking, oh, those are the sins of your youth. And that was a common phrase. I've heard it preached. The sins of your youth. You got to conquer those. And I kept thinking, boy, when I get those conquered, when I get older, the Christian life is going to be a walk in the park. Because I will have conquered the sins of my youth, and from then on, living a good Christian life is going to be so easy. There'll be no more temptations. That didn't work out for me. The sins of your youth is a misnomer. There's no such thing. I think there's sins of our inexperience. And as we grow in the Christian life, become a little wiser, we know how to prepare and handle and deal with temptations and so that we resist them better. But the older I get, the more I realize that those same old sins from 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, 60 years ago, 65, 66 years ago, keep coming back. And you got to stand strong in the Lord, be armed with the in the might of the power of the Holy Spirit every day to resist the temptations, the fiery darts of Satan. And not only these old sinful sins, and may you say, well, I'm going to grow out of my sins of the youth and I'm going to grow into what? Your sins of old age. The sins are still sins. They're still there. The flesh. As we get older, we have different sinful sins of the flesh that drag us down. In the world, there's certain other things in the world. Maybe now we're older and we have more stuff and we have more money to buy more stuff. And there's different temptations in the world. And Satan, he hasn't changed, but he knows that you're getting older and wiser. And so he changes his tactics on you. Nothing's changed. And so now I'm dealing with the sins of my old age. And there are sins and temptations of old age. And may I just throw these out for some of you who are younger that you get to look forward to: stubbornness, stinginess, crankiness. And I do apologize. I do feel like I'm getting cranky at times. Critical, bitter, gossip, complaining, depressed. You know, discouragement and depression is sinful. And we all go through it. whether it's days or weeks or months. But it's when we lose hope, when we lose faith and our trust in the Lord, and we lose the joy, that's sinful. That means we're not walking in tune with Christ as we ought to. And I think as we get older, we fall into that more unteachable, get more set in our ways. Most surely we are correct in everything we've always done and believed, and we become unteachable. And then we, as our mental and physical capacities dwindle, we begin feeling more worthless. I can't do what I used to do. I can't be involved as I used to or in the same way. And I'm disabled, I can't get around, I can't drive, I can't do this. And we start feeling worthless, giving up. Older folks become infirm and they want to give up life. But life is precious. Life is a gift of God. And it's not ever right to give up and say, no, my life is of no use to God anymore. I can't do this. I can't. Yes, but we can do so much. We become judgmental or unsympathetic for this new crybaby generation. Maybe I shouldn't have put it in those words. Maybe I gave it away. I'm a little critical.
Thin skin.
The snowflake generation. Let's not be name calling here. I already did it. This crybaby generation is the generation that my generation produced. That we bought and provided and entitled them to everything. Forgot to discipline them and teach them how to work. Every time I get up here and start preaching, it seems like time flies and I'm running out of time. Turn over to Psalm 90, if you will. Psalm chapter 90. Psalm chapter 90. Moses, the man of God, it's entitled. Prayer of Moses, the man of God. The prayer actually doesn't start until down in verses 13, 14, 15 there, or the prayer. But the whole thing is entitled The Prayer of Moses. And I believe that this was written concerning their time in the wilderness. 40 years Israel wandered in the wilderness. Well, first of all, I should say we begin before that. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the forefathers, the fathers of promise, they wandered in the land of promise, in the land of Canaan. It wasn't their possession yet. They wandered around, lived in tabernacles or tents. And then they ended up in Egypt 400 years. That wasn't their home either, was it? It was a house of bondage, slavery. And then God brought them out. And almost everything we have recorded for us about their wanderings in the wilderness for 40 years, actually, all we have recorded happened in about the first 2 years. Okay? The other 38 years, we really know almost nothing about, other than that they died off. Because remember God said that you people who don't believe, this was back when they didn't, they sent out the spies to go into the land, and Israel didn't believe that, they believed the lies of the ten instead of the two, Joshua and Caleb. Anyways, God says, anybody over this age, you're going to die in the wilderness. You're not going to enter the promised land. And so hundreds of thousands, if not 1 million, 2 million people or more died in the wilderness over those 38-year period of time. And that's what he's writing about here. Really, when you're out here just wandering around waiting to die, now that's really a picture of our pilgrim life. That's what we are. We come into this world and we've got 50, 60, 70 years and then it's appointed unto men once to die, and after that the judgment, the swiftness of time. And that's what he talks about here. Notice in verse 1, follow along as I read, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. He's looking back and saying, you know, our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, they didn't have a place to live. That wasn't their home. Egypt wasn't our home. This wilderness isn't our home. But you have been our refuge. You have been our home. When we're with you, we're home. Because you're the eternal God. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. the eternity of God. And he's going to bring this out because here we're talking about a whole generation of Jews. 1 million to 2 million Jews are going to die in this 38-year period. Life is brief. But in comparison to eternity and God, you, that's what we're comparing to. Our life is nothing. He says in verse 3, you turn man to destruction and say, return, O children of men. Because 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it's past. Like a watch in the night, you carry them away like a flood. They're like sleep. In the morning, they're like grass which grows up. In the morning, it flourishes and grows up. In the evening, it's cut down and withers. We have been consumed by your anger. And they're talking about now that they're under the judgment of God because we didn't believe God, and now we're going to have to die in the wilderness. We're not going to be allowed to go into the promised land. And so they say, we're being consumed by your anger. By your wrath, we are terrified. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your countenance. For all our days have passed away in your wrath. We finish our years like a sigh. The days of our lives are 70 years, and if by reason of strength they are 80, yet their boast is only labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away. Who knows the power of your anger? For is the fear of you, so is your wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom, or may apply our hearts to wisdom. He talks about the swiftness, how brief life is, how fleeting life is, really. Especially when we look at God, who's from everlasting to everlasting, who had no beginning and has no end. And he says in verse 4, he says, whether it's like yesterday when it is past, like a watch in the night. A watch in the night. The Jews divided the nighttime, the sleep period, into either 3 or 4 watches of maybe 2, 3, 4 hours each. And so a watch was just like 3 or 4 hours. And so it's like a watch in the night. And it's like you turn over in your bed and you look at the clock and you go, oh, it's 2:30. And you roll over and then the alarm's going off. Oh, it's 6:30, 4 hours later. Wow, it's time to get up already. That's how fast life is, he says. It's like a watch in the night. You're sleeping. It's gone. Verse 5, he says, it's like a flood. You carry them away like a flood. People, lives, generations are coming and going. And here this whole generation is going to die in the wilderness because of their unbelief in God. And Moses says it's like a flood. Death comes, it's like a flood. And it mows them down like a huge flood, just carries away everything. And that's the way our life is. We think we're here on solid ground. A flood comes. We're gone. We're gone. Like a flood. Maybe the suddenness of it also. A flood comes unexpectedly. That's why most people perish in floods. Because they didn't prepare or flee the flood. And it just comes. Reminds me of those tsunamis that hit in some of those places. Just devastating. The big waves comes up on shore and just miles inland and just destroys everything. The suddenness of a flood takes away our life. I remember years ago, my wife and I have gotten the paper for years. And up 35 years maybe we've been getting the paper. 34 years I never read obituary. I remember asking Becky once. She says, oh yeah, I read the obituary every day. And I thought, well, that's more, but that's terrible, Becky. Why would you read the obituary? I read it every day now. I'll see if I'm in it. If I wake up and see my picture, I know I'm in trouble. But I skimmed down through to see if there's anybody from Marion or Williamson. So they give up in one little bracket. They give the town where a person lived. And then they also give the age quite often. And so I just kind of marked the age. And there's almost every other day or so somebody that's 100, 102 years old and in their 90s. And I go, wow, that's neat. And then there's almost always somebody in their 30s, 40s, 50s. And then I also look to see if there's any Jewish stars, if they're old and if what their Jewish history was interests me. Anyways, the flood, it carries away people. It doesn't matter whether they're male or female, young or old. It doesn't matter whether they're rich or poor, whether they were famous like a Barbara Walters or the Pope. It doesn't matter. It comes like a flood and carries people away. That's your life. It does not discriminate. Verse 5 also says, like a sleep. They are like a sleep, like a dream. You go to sleep and you wake up, it's over. You have a dream. How long does a dream last? Seems to me, I always thought the dreams, I thought I dreamed all night long. And some people say, no, you only dream those few seconds before you wake up. I don't know. But it's like a sleep, the swiftness of your life. Here it is. It's gone. Like a dream. Here it is, gone. Maybe he means by that it's surreal. It's not real. You dreamed like you were having a big turkey feast and you were eating and had all this delicious food and you're eating and drinking and great. You wake up and you're hungry. I must not have really been eating. I thought I was. It was just a dream. It wasn't reality. And I'm unsatisfied. Whatever was happening, it didn't turn out that way. It was just a dream. Our lives are like that. We think everything's going great. All of a sudden, oh, that was just a dream. Now I stand before God and reality begins. What I was thinking of was life, was nothing. That was a dream. And sometimes people do that. They go through this life living for possessions and things and stuff. And all of a sudden death comes. It's appointed unto men once to die. And after that, the judgment. We're standing before God. And all of a sudden, we realize that my whole life, all that stuff that I thought was important, no, that was but a dream. Gone. Now reality begins. It says, in the morning they are like grass which grows up. In the morning it flourishes, it grows up. In the evening it's cut down and withers. Grass, hayfield, grows up, green, lush, alfalfa, clover. Cut it down, sun, wind, dries it, changes color, turns it light brown, shade of green. There it is. Last summer, I was at my cousin's farm, and I was raking some hay for him. He'd cut it down the day before, and so I was just raking it in. The windrows, flipping them over, actually. And in the one corner field, they come around the corner, and there was a nice breeze blowing. Well, it must have come around the corner, and it developed one of those little funnels, like a mini. And I see these windrows. I mean, like 100 feet in the air, just... Well, there goes that hay. Just to think, yesterday it was there thriving as a growing plant, and Bill cut it down, and the next thing you know, whoosh, it's to the wind. Well, that's what your life is like. We grow up, we think we're strong and sturdy and grow, and next thing you know, we're getting feeble and old, and life is over. It happens quick. It's like grass. And then he says in verse 9, all our days have passed away in your wrath. We finish our years like a sigh. Like a sigh. The King James Version has like a tale that is told. Whether it's a sigh, a mutter, a thought in our hearts, or whether it's a tale that we actually tell. Some commentaries think that this tale that is told is the tale of a eulogy, the story of one's life. And I got thinking about that and thinking of the eulogies that I've given over the years. And here a person lives for 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years. And I get up and in 5 minutes, I give a eulogy that covers his whole life. It's nothing. You know, on the tombstone, it's just that dash. 1959 to 2021. It's at 60 years. And there's the dash between them. Your whole life is nothing but a little dash. Like a sigh. Maybe it's a little fireside chat. Remember when Dan told us that little story a few years ago about the... No, I don't remember it either, Dan. Sorry. We tell a little story. We tell a tale. A word out of the mouth, and where does it go? Into thin air. A sigh. That's what our life is like. James says what? James 4 says, what's your life? It's even a vapor. Appears for a little while and then vanishes. That's it. We think sitting through English class when I was in eighth grade. I thought it would never end. And yet, life as a whole, it's gone. Job says, my days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle. Learned something about cloth this week. I used to think it was the warp and woof. It's not, it's the warp and weft. I don't know where a woof came from. It's the warp and weft. And the warp are the, on a loom, are the threads that go this way, and then they divide and separate. And then the shuttle has the thread, it goes horizontal to that. That's the weft, the shuttle, and he runs that through and then pulls it, and those things switch sides, and then you run the shuttle through the other way, and then the other way, and you keep pulling it down. That's the warp and the weft are the two different things of the fiber. But he says, your life, he says, it's swifter than a weaver's shuttle. And the emphasis really is on the swiftness of the weaver. And his work and his hands are just a blur. Like anything you would do, a craft that you've done for 40 or 50 years, it's to him, it's just, and someone else looking by, it's just a blur. And Job says, that's what your life is like. Swifter than a weaver's shuttle. I couldn't help but think a week or so ago, seeing little Austin and Kennedy, how fast time flies, because my little Jed man and Amos Lupus were that age just a couple years ago. Oh no, it was 35 years ago. And many of you here remember Amy as a baby. Well, not many of you. Some of you remember Amy as a baby. Time flies. Oh my, how time flies. And Paul commands us to redeem the time because the days are evil. There's full of problems and everything else. And he says, but redeem the time. The word redeem means buy up. Buy up. And most other modern translations actually translate it, make the best use of the time. Buy it up and use it wisely. In other words, prioritize your time on people, not things. Relationship with your spouse, with your children, with your grandchildren, with your Christian friend. Build relationships and with people who matter and be a godly influence them. There's a lot of things in this world that are important. Unfortunately, we get carried away. We can't tend to the things that are important because of the things that are urgent. I remember reading a quote once. It said, urgent, perhaps. Important, probably not. In fact, in pastoral theology class, one of my old professors, he said, if you ever get a piece of mail that says open immediately, throw it in the trash. Do not open. If it says urgent, throw it in the trash. And if it's urgent, important, today only, throw it in the trash. Don't even listen to it. It's not important. You know what's important. Make the best use of your time. And I guess I don't have time for this. But the older I get, the more important I realize how rest and sleep and meditation. Redeeming the time, taking time to rest one day in seven is not wasteful, by the way. It's God's command. And I learned the hard way of running continuously without taking a day off every seven. God commanded it because his frail children, we need it mentally, spiritually, emotionally, physically, to rest one day in seven. He calls us to be industrious, punctual, faithful, but then to rest one day in seven. Meditation is something also that I've been trying for the last few years and have done a lot better than I used to. It's not a time of waste. Meditation is not transcendental, where we're emptying our minds. Biblical meditation is where we soak our minds in the Word of God. Read a passage of Scripture, read a verse of Scripture, and meditate on that. Sit down in the quiet, close your eyes, and think about the Word of God. Meditation without the Word of God is dangerous. You do not let your mind run wild. Do not let your imaginations run free. Meditation is to think thoroughly about the Word of God. Put some objective truth in your mind
to let it soak in. That's what meditation's about, putting the Word of God in there and thinking about it, ruminating on it like a cow does, chewing your cud. That's what he means when he talks about meditating on the Word of God. Well, those were my ponderings, my testimonies, my encouragement for you for resolves for the new year. Heavenly Father, we just pray that some of this would be a blessing to people, that they would resolve to go on with Christ, to live for him more faithfully, to serve him more diligently, to resist sin's temptations more strongly, to love others more, to prioritize their time with people rather than things. Lord, give us wisdom, give us discernment, give us insight. Help us to make resolutions that would honor you and further your work, we pray, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. If you would, take your hymn books and join me in singing just the first verse of hymn number 396, I'll Live for Him. 396, just the first verse. Greg, would you close us in prayer?
Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for the message that was presented to us. And Lord, help us to apply it throughout the remainder of the week. And Lord, we know these days are going by really fast. As you get older, it goes by really faster. But as that does happen, help us to cherish it more. For you, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.